Sunday you drive your tractor to church. I love it. I see one red tractor, one green tractor out there. So no fighting during worship, all right? It is a joy to be our farmers this morning as we celebrate a terrific year that God has blessed us with. Great crops, great weather, great community. So welcome to Redeemer Lutheran this morning. A few announcements before we continue. This upcoming Saturday, Dennis Remington will be speaking at the Men in Mission monthly meeting, monthly gathering. This month will be at St. Paul's Rural Hooper. So please join him this upcoming Saturday. And actually, Dennis is with us this morning as well. So Dennis is making the rounds. Dennis is from Camps Carol Joy Hauling. So he'll be sharing a little bit about the camp. So the ministry is there, and some other opportunities. Now here at Redeemer, we send our confirmation students to Camp Carol every summer. Last summer we had 9 kids go to camp. This upcoming summer we'll have at least 6 youth go to Camp Carol. So terrific ministry and just a chance for the kids to really ignite their faith. Today, if you are hungry, United Lutheran Church is hosting their Harvest Brunch. It is an all-you-can-eat scrambled eggs, ham, pancakes, French toast, fruit cup, juice, and coffee. That's from 9 a.m. this morning till 1 p.m. in the Moore Auditorium in Scribner. Free will donations are accepted. Next Sunday is another opportunity for breakfast. The BFW is holding their annual feed. Pancakes, sausage, and scrambled eggs. Once again, all you can eat. And again, a free will offering donation will be accepted. A few other things. On your way home, we are once again hosting our annual Advent Family Night. We've done this in the past year at Redeemer. We didn't do it last year. We're bringing it back, though. So we love our families or anybody at all if you're interested in supper together, singing some Christmas songs together, some crafts together. This is open to everybody. Please sign up. That sign-up sheet is found right next to you and right beneath the confirmation pictures back there in the fellowship hall. Next week, believe it or not, we are starting our Christmas sermon series. I know what you're saying, Pastor, it's too early for Christmas, and I know it is too early for Christmas. This is a 5-week series, and so we got started a little bit earlier. We'll take a look at Mary, we'll take a look at Joseph, we'll take a look at Nazareth and Bethlehem, we'll take a look at the real places, where they lived, what it would have been like, how old were they, what would their experiences been like. So it'll be a great sermon series. We hope that you will join us beginning next Sunday. Lastly, here at Redeemer, we are doing a food drive. We are trying to collect 500 non-perishable food items. If we're able to collect those 500 food items, we will also have $500 donated through Thrivent that all goes to the Faith Food Pantry. You'll notice toward the back of the church on this side, we have a table set up. Please either put your items there on the table or underneath as we continue to collect items throughout November. Our worship continues this morning with our Harvest Remembrance of God, found on page 1 of your bulletin. The heavens declare the glory of God. The skies display the work of his hands. God of light and God of night, creator of seed and mountain, raindrop and fountain, we bring our offering of praise. God of right and God of might, lover of child and childless, rich and homeless, we bring our offering of praise. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. As long as the earth endures, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night will never cease. By faith, I gaze up to the heavens and know within its vastness that this is your creation, planned and effected within eternity. By faith, I harvest an ear of corn and know within its symmetry lies the chemistry of life, the potential of creation within my hand. In gratitude, I thank you, Heavenly Father, for the abundant harvest you have blessed us with this year. We now bring forward some of the crop you have blessed us with as we lift our voices in praise. Would you please rise, and as we sing our opening hymn, I invite our farmers, our farming family, to please bring forward your corn or your soybeans. We will put these in the containers up here as we thank God for the bountiful harvest that he's blessed us with. So please rise as we sing, and farmers, I invite you forward for the beauty of the earth.
Counselor, so there was a lot of wet beds, sleeping bags, So we now get to sleep in the new Hazel Dillon Lodge that has air conditioning, and it is, the kids just had a ball. But they'll still get that outside experience because they'll get to go out at least one night to sleep in the platform tents. Two other parts of that program is we don't turn any children away. We have two camps, Carol Joy Holly at Ashland, and we also have another camp out at Sullivan Hills at Lodgepole called Sullivan Hills. And we've been blessed out there that we have two foundations and one individual that underwrites the cost of camp to all the kids. So all the kids that go to Sullivan Hills, they get to go free. They have to give a $50 deposit just to make sure they show up. When they get there, they get that $50 back. Our goal, one of our goals, is we can do that at Carol Joy Holly. So part of our Trailhead campaign is a $1.5 million endowment to help us get to that goal. But the one that I'm the most excited about is our seminary scholarship. We've had 49 of our young men and women that have been camp counselors go into the full-time ministry. And I don't know if you know that it's pretty expensive to go through seminary. I have one pastor that I work with that she told me after she graduated she had over $80,000 in debt that she had to pay off for her college education. And you know, as a pastor's salary, that's going to take a long time to get that paid for. So we have started a $500,000 endowment to scholarship any of our summer staff that goes in to the full-time ministry. And we were very fortunate that we've raised a little over $100,000 so far, and we were able to give two $500 scholarships to a couple that I encouraged every time I saw them when I was at camp. Hillary and Evan Christensen will graduate this spring, and they were the first from the seminary in Pennsylvania, and they were our first recipients of our scholarship. So you have many different ways that you can help support us. So if you're interested, I'll be out after church. I'll share with you how you can become a fire starter, get a nice walking stick. And if you'd like me to come and visit you, I'll bring nice homemade chocolate chip cookies. And we have good conversations and share all the different ways that you can help Carol Joy Calling. And again, I want to thank Redeemer for all that you've done, sending kids to camp, your financial support, and your prayers. So keep us in your prayers, the staff and all the summer staff that come to share the love of Jesus to all those kids. And we're finding, the interesting thing is, we have a lot of people being scholarshiped. We're finding that 25% of the kids that are coming to camp don't even know what church is. I live in Fremont, I go to Salem. I got the honor this year to drive our church bus with 13 quiet children going to daycare. And it was, so I got to work, that week I got to work at the camp all week. I'm usually out on the road. But there was one boy that a friend brought him to day camp. And he'd never heard of Jesus. He'd never been in church. So that's what it's all about. Changing one life at a time, sharing the good news of Jesus Christ. So thanks for inviting me, and God bless you.
Trees that were pleasing to the eye and good for food. In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and take care of it. And the Lord God commanded the man, "You are free to eat from the tree in the garden, but you must not eat from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. For when you eat from it, you will certainly die." Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Our second lesson is taken from Deuteronomy, the 24th chapter. Do not take advantage of a hired worker who is poor and needy, whether that worker is a fellow Israelite or a foreigner residing in one of your towns. Pay them their wages each day before sunset, because they are poor and are counting on it. Otherwise, they may cry to the Lord against you, and you will be guilty of sin. When you are harvesting in your field and you overlook a sheep, do not go back to get it. Take it for the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow, so that the Lord your God may bless you in all the work of your hands. When you beat the olives from your trees, do not go over the branches a second time. Leave what remains for the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow. When you harvest the grapes in your vineyard, do not go over the vines again. Leave what remains for the foreigner, the fatherless, and the widow. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Just a spoon.
spoonful of sugar helps the medicine go down. Oh!
Thank you.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the 12th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus said, "Watch out for the teachers of the law. They like to walk around in flowing robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and have the most important seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for a show make lengthy prayers. These men will be punished most severely." Jesus sat down opposite the place where the offerings were put and watched the crowd putting their money into the temple treasury. Many rich people threw in large amounts, but a poor widow came and put in two very small copper coins, worth only a few cents. Calling his disciples to him, Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, this poor widow has put more into the treasury than all the others. They all gave out of their wealth, but she, out of her poverty, put in everything, all she had to live on." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please remain standing as we sing our contemporary praise, "Shine, Jesus, shine."
Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us.
little bit lighthearted. And I heard about this reporter for the USA Today. It was on this mission to go across the United States visiting different churches. And one of the very first churches she visited was in New York City. She joined for worship that morning and then afterwards was in the pastor's office. And in the pastor's office, she saw something that really caught her eye. She saw this golden telephone there on the pastor's desk. And next to it was this sign that said, calls to heaven, $10,000 per minute. So she asked the pastor, what's the deal? And the pastor said, well, if you've got enough money and you really want to speak to heaven, you use this phone, call heaven, and you have a direct line to God in heaven. She continued to travel throughout the country, and every place she sought, every single church in the pastor's office was that golden phone with the same sign, $10,000 per minute to talk to God in heaven. She finally made her way to Nebraska. She stopped for worship and then went to the pastor's office and saw the same golden phone. But rather than $10,000 per minute, she saw the sign read 25 cents per minute. And she asked the pastor, is this a mistake? Is there something wrong with your sign here? The pastor said, no, no, you're in Nebraska. Now it's a local call. That's one of my favorite ones. That's a good one. Kathy, I don't have a clicker, so if I'll give you that sign, go to the next slide if you would for me. But actually, give me two if you would. It is a joy to be doing this Harvest Celebration worship service. This has been something that I've thought about doing for a number of years. However, trying to figure out the right time to start something like this isn't always easy to do, because if you're a farmer, you know that some years you get the rain, some years you get the drought. And it seems that most summers you have someone that might live south of town get all the rain, while people north of town completely miss it. The next year, it's completely the opposite. Some years you get pockets of hail and then farmers' crops are completely wiped out. You just don't ever know what you're going to get. And so I thought, what better year to start this new tradition, this idea of having this annual Harvest Celebration worship service, because God's been good to us, hasn't he? Can I hear an amen to that?
Amen.
Come on, Lutherans, let's do better than that. Amen?
Amen.
I'm not done preaching yet, but it's been a terrific year. As I've talked to a lot of farmers, God has been good to us. We've had great yields. We've had pretty good prices. It's been a good year to be here in Nebraska and a good year to be a farmer. But you know, Scripture tells us that even in those bad years, we are meant to give God thanks. In fact, in the Bible, in 1 Thessalonians 5:18, God's word says this: to give thanks in all circumstances. Don't give thanks only in 2021, and if 2022 brings, you know, a drier year and grumble a little bit, God's word tells us to give thanks in all circumstances, for this is the will of God in Christ Jesus for you. I love this. There's two types of people. There's people that always find the positive in whatever type of situation they find themselves in. No matter what life throws at them, 2020 was a terrible year, but some people found good things in it, as they found time to connect with families, as they found time to connect deeper with God. And life is going to be this way. There's good times, there's bad times, but the Bible tells us in all times there's things to be thankful for. And we just have to be persistent in finding those things to truly give God thanks and praise. The ability to wake up this morning, to put 2 feet on the ground, to come to worship our God. The gift, the ability to have loved ones, to have friends, to have a church to come to. God has truly blessed us with. Hogemeyer man. Now you may be wondering, where's my Hogemeyer? I looked in my closet, I don't have any. I'm ashamed to say that. I couldn't find, I've got a Hogemeyer coat, but I don't have a Hogemeyer shirt, but it's good to see so many of you dressed up this morning. But first I want to lift up, what was agriculture like in the Bible? Did they have crops? Was it soybeans? Was it corn? What did farmers do back during the time of Jesus? And farmers back in Jesus' time, there's essentially two different growing seasons. The first growing season, the farmers would sow, they didn't plant, they would sow wheat and barley. And planting season for wheat and barley was in the fall. We still do this. If you're a wheat farmer, you typically plant it in the fall. Grows a little bit, it's dormant in the winter, then it spruces back up in the spring, and the farmers back in Jesus' time, they would harvest it. And the harvest for the farmers back during Jesus' time, the wheat and barley typically took place in April. And they would harvest it in April right before their biggest holiday celebration, what they call the Passover. And the Passover is the day that the Israelite people, the Jewish people, celebrate the moment that God sent the angel of death to Egypt to kill the firstborn son of all Egyptians, but spared the Israelites. He spared the Jewish people, and through this night, the Jewish people were saved. They were free. And so a lot of the Israelite farmers, they would take their wheat crop, they would gather it, and they would make unleavened bread, meaning bread that did not rise to celebrate this holiday. It was their Christmas, it was their Easter in a lot of different ways. Now, sometimes people might wonder, did they have cattle back in Israel? And there was a little bit of cattle, there was a little bit of oxen, but the main type of animal livestock was sheep. God. Jesus often talks about shepherds. In fact, Jesus calls himself the good shepherd. But if you were a shepherd back in Jesus' time, you were not very well liked. And you were not very well liked because you more than likely did not own your own land. You see, the grassland in Israel, it was really hard to find one plot of land that they could keep their sheep on the entire summer. So the shepherds would very often take their sheep and they would travel around from one farm to the next. And when you saw those shepherds come with their 100 head of sheep onto your land and you're a farmer, you grumble and you didn't like to see the shepherds. And so shepherds back in Jesus' time were kind of the lowest of the farmers. But the second type of harvest back in Jesus' time was grapes and it was olives. And the grapes, sometimes they turned to wine, sometimes they would just eat as grapes. But they would plant the grapes, or they would start the planting season in early spring. And now grapes in Israel, and grapes in general, has a pretty wide window to harvest it. You can begin harvest in early June, and harvest can lead all the way up into late September. But come about the 1st of October, it was no longer a good time to harvest because that was the rainy season. And the farmers had to be out of the vineyards, they had to be out of the fields by about the beginning of October. Farmers. The farmers that I know, they drive this, and I suppose I picked a Case tractor there, so I probably made half of our farmers angry. I just found this on Google, so please forgive your pastor here this morning. But the farmers that I know follow three typical patterns of living their life. I call them the three H's. Farmers are humble, farmers are hardworking, and farmers are honest people. If you ever see a farmer, you know they're a humble person. How often you talk about to a farmer, and the first thing they do is they start bragging about the yields that they have in their fields. Now, they may exist. I don't think I've come across many of them, but you talk to farmers about how their crop grew this year, and they'll say, yeah, God's been good to me. And sometimes I want to dig for a little bit more, you know, what was the yield? Did you get 200 bushels an acre inch? It's hard to do this. As farmers are humble people. They know that God's blessed them this year, but a lot of times they don't want to talk about numbers because of that humbleness. And that is such a good quality that our farmers have. trust God. Let me say that again. Farmers have learned to trust God. Some of them may have been born with this, but I'm guessing if you've been a farmer for longer than 2, 3, 4 years, you realize what I'm talking about. Farmers have to trust that the minute that they put the seed into the ground in the spring, that God will provide for them. When a farmer puts the corn or the soybeans in the ground come April, what do? They trust God will provide. They trust God will bring those timely rains. They trust that God will keep the different pests and the different worms and the different types of things that want to eat at the crops away. They have to trust God. They plant. There's a few things they do throughout the season, but a lot of it is just trusting that God will care for their crops. I love this quote from Charles Spurgeon. To trust God in the light is nothing, but to trust Him in the dark, that is faith. Friends in Christ, it's easy to trust God when things are going good. It's easy to praise God when times are good. It's easy to trust when everything's going our way. It's much harder when life is difficult. It's much harder when we look at our fields and those crops are withering up a little bit. But that is what our farmers do. They trust Him. As I close out my message this morning, there's a video that was a part of the Super Bowl commercial. Whole Super Bowl Sunday, I think it was 2012, and in it, Paul Harvey has a poem titled, God Made a Farmer. So I'd like to close my message with that this morning, so please take a look at our screens as we watch God Made a Farmer, and let's make sure that our volume is loud enough. Please pray with me. Hey, Father, we thank You. We thank You for our farmers. We thank You for all the people that work at the grain elevators, drive the grain trucks, for all the people that are involved in the agricultural business. Father, we are so very, very grateful for a great year. We're grateful for the abundant yield, the abundant harvest. We pray now that our corn and our soybeans may help feed the world, that it may go to those hungry places, that it may go to those places that are in need. We thank You and we praise You. We pray that Your blessing continue to lift up our farmers, keep them safe, that they may continue to do Your good work. All this we pray in Jesus' name. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This time I'll please ask our ushers to bring forward this morning's offering, and as they do, let us sing, "We Are an Offering." A special thank you to our guests and our visitors that have joined us this morning. I thank you once again to Dennis Remington for being with us in worship as well. At the church today, we've got Sunday school. We've got donuts and coffee once again. So please join us in the fellowship hall for some good conversation. Also this morning, adult Bible study. We'll be taking a look at the devil and demons. What does the Bible tell us about that? What can we learn from that? So if this is a topic that you've been interested in, wanting to learn more about, there's no preparation needed whatsoever. We'll just take a look at God's Word, learn a little bit more about the devil and demons. We'd love to have you join us. We'll meet in the parlor. There's a room right over here. Grab some coffee, grab a donut, and join us for that adult Bible study here after worship. Hear now our final lesson. May the God of harvest, we praise you for your goodness. Feed us, equip us, and having provided for us, we look to a different harvest, a fruitfulness of lives and service to you and to others. God of harvest, feed us, prune us, harvest us, that our lives might bring glory to you. Amen. Go in peace, serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.